background about HIV drugs, because I think a lot of people are not aware of what are the kind of drugs that are available. But the drugs are divided into three main groups, the NRTIs, the NNRTIs, and the PIs. The NRTIs, the drugs that are available, are zidovudine, lamivudine, sarudine, zidinazine, abacavir, amphotericin, tenofovir. And whenever we start treatment of HIV, it's always going to be three drugs minimum, of which two drugs are from this group. So you have two drugs from the NRTI group. Of your NNRTIs, you have nevirapine and infavirenz. You have a newer second generation NNRTI that has now come, that is known as itavirin. And it is used basically for drug resistance HIV. Among your PIs, you have a whole gamut of PIs, but very few that are actually recommended for children. The commonest ones that are used in children are lopinavir, ritonavir. Now remember, ritonavir is not a drug that is to be used alone. It's always used along with a second PI. It's basically called as a boosted regime. So when you use ritonavir combination, say for example lopinavir, ritonavir, or you use atazanavir, ritonavir, these are boosted PIs. What it does, it decreases the metabolism of the primary PI. So it decreases the metabolism of lopinavir or something else. So it decreases the chance of developing drug resistance. So whenever now the recommendation is, if you're going to use a PI, use a boosted PI. Don't use a PI without an unboosted regimen. Back to the history of HIV. HIV is a disease that came in the 1980s. The first drug came in 1987, that is zidovudine. So people were really, okay, something's come with the treatment, let me start. And zidovudine was a drug that was actually formulated for treatment of cancer. So you can imagine the kind of toxicity that this drug must be having. So people started using this drug, and this is the viral load that is there. You can see that the viral load decreased and then again started rising. So it didn't work that well. Then came the era of two drugs, that was in 1994. That was the time zidinazine came into the market. Viral load went down further up, but again started rising. And then in 1997 came the era of HART, free drug regimen. Viral load went down and remained suppressed. So that's the reason why we are giving triple drug therapy for our patients with HIV. Now, the confusion. Why is drug resistance on the rise? HIV is a treatment which is going to be lifelong. So you're going to have a child on a regimen that is going to be lifelong. Most of these patients are going to fail the regimen sometime down the line. Maybe it's going to be 10 years, 15 years, depending on what was the first line you started. So they're going to fail their first line. Now the confusion that is occurring, because the guidelines have evolved over a period of years. We have a number of guidelines to follow for HIV. You've got the US guidelines, you've got the WHO guidelines, you've got the NAPO guidelines, and you've got the European, there is the PENTA guidelines. And these guidelines keep on getting updated. I'll just take you through a story of the guidelines. 2004 US guidelines mentioned any infant with HIV, no matter whether it's symptomatic, asymptomatic, whatever the CD4 count, treat these patients. Children over 1 year, CD4 count less than 15. Three motor symptoms and 4 weeks age defining illness. So WHO said anyone in stage 3 or 4, that means moderate to severe disease, treat them. And anyone who is mildly symptomatic or the one who is asymptomatic, do a CD4 count and then treat them. Now what were their cutoffs? Their cutoffs were different. They had less than 1 year, 25%. 1 year to 36 months, 20%. Three years to 5 years, 15%. And after 5 years, they said 200 CD4 count. So people in Europe follow different guidelines, people in India follow the different guidelines, people in Africa follow the different guidelines for a disease that is the same. So US guidelines again updated it in 2006, and they said 1 to 4 years, 20%, 4 years to 12 years, 15%, and after 13 years, 200. So there was a varying in the guideline. 2009, WHO realized, 200 is too less, we need to go back to HR. This was the era of 1997, when everybody was treating every patient with HIV with an AIT. They said, okay, HR. Again, that era has come back. Why? Because they feel that the survival is much better. Organ-related dysfunctions of HIV are going to be prevented. Now, when we checked, why do you think we need to do this HR? If you go through our data, pediatric HIV comorbidities, cardiological problems, Dr. Prabhu will remember this, 77%, 72% have a growth failure. neurological problems, 48 children with neurological problems. If you can see this, problems in HIV, hepatitis, splenomegaly, lymphadenopathy, TB, failure to thrive, skin diseases, PO, diarrhea, lots of problems. So now if we compare the current guidelines, this is 2009-2010 guidelines. Infants, everybody has made a consensus, treat all. So WHO has gone from CD4 guided in infants to now 10 treat all. So in infants, no CD4 guided. 1 year to 2 years, US still mentions go according to the CD4 count or the clinical stage. Same thing with the Penta guidelines, the European. Whereas WHO says now anyone less than 2 years treat all. 2 years to 3 years is CD4 guided and clinical guided. Now 3 years to 5 years, WHO says anyone less than 500. Whereas here everybody says less than 25%. So again we have a difference. But now the cutoff has been raised to 350 instead of 200. So now we are back to starting therapy much earlier. Which ART regimen? We've got 22 drugs. Which one to start with? We know that the backbone has to be 2 NRTI. So our backbone is going to be 2 NRTI. Can we use an NNRTI? Yes, the third drug could be an NNRTI. Or the third drug could be a PI. Now this is where the problem was. When the rollout took place, the pediatric formulation that was available was tabudin based. So we had tabudin, lamivudin and nevirapine as pediatric tablets that were available. Now what the guidelines mention, tabudin is no longer recommended as a treatment of choice in children. So we've got thousands of children in India who've been started on tabudin based regimen, which now have to be shifted to a better regimen. And that is what we have also observed, that when we have given tabudin as a first line therapy, most of them fail by the end of 3 years or 4 years. So we are actually giving them an inferior regimen and they're going to fail earlier. And we've got thousands of children in the country on this regimen. Now the recommendation is adacalate with lamivudin as an NRTI backbone for the treatment of children. So we are going to face problems with drug resistance very soon. Again, I'm stressing ART is a lifelong therapy, so treatment failure is imperative. And when would you suspect drug resistance? When a child is failing a regimen or a child has taken intermittent regimen. Causes of treatment failure would be poor adherence. Something you are taking a cap. We do not take 5 days antibiotics. We are expecting somebody to take lifelong therapy. It's going to be difficult. Another problem is we don't monitor their drug levels. So we don't really know whether they are in the therapeutic range. And lots of drug interactions with AKT, with antifungals. Now this was another study that was done. We had 30 patients of ART and nevirapine and efavirenz. 7 of them were taking simultaneous rifampicin. If you can look through the guidelines, they mentioned that you are not supposed to use rifampicin with your nevirapine. But we continued all these patients on nevirapine, just increasing the dose of nevirapine by 30%. And what did we get? We monitored their TDM and they were all in the normal range. So if you are able to monitor the TDM levels, you will be able to manage their drug compliance and their drug therapy without causing resistance. Now, this was the 1990s. If you can imagine the number of pills that a child would be taking every 10 per day. Now we've got formulations where we can give them therapy once a day. So 10 pills a day, no child is going to take this. Drug interactions with food is another problem, so you need to be very careful about which drug you're giving, with food, with fatty food, pre-meal. Most of 11% of our patients have failed the therapy at our center, and 30% do have side effects when they're on therapy. Now, what are the regimens for treatment failure? This is what WHO recommends, that if you have started zidovudin, lamivudin, change to abacavir, lamivudin. If you have started tabudin, lamivudin, change again to abacavir, lamivudin. If you have already started abacavir as a first line, then change to zidovudin, lamivudin or change to zidovudin, didanosine. Regarding the NRTI, if you are on an NRTI, change to a PR. This is the treatment for drug failure. CHIVA guidelines, these are the British guidelines, are a little different. But what is important is when do you recognize treatment failure? Failure is either clinical, immunological or virological. This is the importance of monitoring a viral load. When you're starting the treatment, viral load is high. It gets suppressed in the next 6 months and it's supposed to remain like this, suppressed. In practice, this is what happens. It's false. rises a blip, comes down, again a blip is much higher, comes down, again the blip is much higher. And these are the times when you actually change therapy without doing the drug resistance testing. And then you have a problem where nothing is working. So ideally, before changing regimen, you should do a drug resistance testing. And in fact, nowadays, with the PPTCT that is going to come into the rollout and Nevirapine being given to all mothers as well as the babies, these babies who become positive should have a drug resistance testing before you start them on any ART. Now, in HIV, we do a genotype testing. Now, if I give you an example, this is a mutation, K103L. This mutation, the K word stands for the amino acid that is naturally present at the codon, whichever is the codon number, and replaced by the amino acid N. That means asparaginase has replaced lysine on codon 103. When you actually go through the resistance, you have a chart like this, and you need to interpret the resistance pattern. So you get a report where they will tell you this is the mutation found, this is the mutation found, and you need to analyze what this mutation stands for. I have highlighted the M184V. 184V tells me this child has become resistant to lanivudin and tricitabine. So these drugs will actually be out of the therapy. Whereas if I have multiple mutations like these, 210 or 67 together, that tells me that the entire group of the NRTR is being lost. So this is something that some of these mutations are in fact very helpful. Like this 184V actually increases the efficacy of zidovudin. So if I have a child who has this mutation, I will still continue lanivudin because it will help the zidovudin. So little confusing that you have to do this until unless you want to have a child failing all the regimen. Similarly for the NNRTIs, you have 103N mutation. If I get this mutation, this whole group is out. I can't use this group at all. So that's the importance of resistance testing. So if we compare genotype assay, less expensive, phenotype assay, more expensive. Results are early in a genotype assay. Phenotype assay takes longer time. Our PD cultures take us 6 weeks. Genotype assays are well standardized. They are more sensitive to detect multi-drug resistance, but the interpretation is a problem. And you keep on getting newer and newer algorithms which you have to update yourself with. So these are the drugs that are available for drug resistant TB. You have the entry inhibitor, that is T20. It's like an insulin injection that you will get twice a day, 1 lakh rupee therapy per month. You have darunavir and tipunavir, they are the new PIs. You have newer entry inhibitors or integrase inhibitors, maraviroc, which is coming. But these are all going to be toxic drugs and no side effects. So my conclusion is that the era of HIV resistance is beginning. Treatment regimens will be more complex, and drug resistance testing is something that we should be looking at before changing a regimen. Thank you.